I assume that many of you are listening and watching this evening spent some time watching the Democratic convention last week. I'll be at the unconventional convention. And, of course, Donald Trump is getting ready to unveil his plans for the Republicans starting tomorrow in four consecutive nights. So we're going to measure exactly what the Democrats tried to do last week, maybe preview a little bit what the Republicans are going to be doing. And then in the second hour, we've got three experts who are really going to dissect this whole issue of voting and when you can vote and when you can't vote and attempts to, you know, cut down on votes. I mean, it's going to be a good, we've got three great experts to join us. I want to begin this evening, Derek Blakely, nice to have you with us. For almost 40 years, you've been a reporter for NBC in Chicago and also CBS, and also you spent 7 years on the CBS network. You recently retired, and now you're at DePaul University, so it's good to have you with us. And we'll also hear from Jeff Holm in just a moment, who's a Republican operative. But when you go to a convention, and you've been to conventions, each party wants to present, obviously, their best face. They want to present a picture of their candidate that nobody can pick on. And I think the Democrats did a pretty good job. They were they didn't say much about policy, but they certainly made the point that Joe Biden was a good man, a decent man. He'd been around a long time. And if you missed it the first 15 times, his son Beau died of cancer. And he made a big point of that, as well as the tragic start of his political career when his wife and daughter were killed on the night that he was first elected. So there's a story of tragedy in Joe Biden's life, and a lot of people know it, but they certainly hit that over and over again. But my question to you is now, as a reporter and looking at what we need to know, because they made such a big case about what a great guy Joe Biden was, and frankly, they wrapped himself in the Beau Biden patina, if you will. Is it fair to look at Hunter Biden? Because Hunter Biden, although he had a brief role the other evening, I mean, Hunter Biden has been the newsmaker in that family, unfortunately, for about a year and a half now. And it's going to be a difficult thing for the Republicans to do it. But is it fair game for the reporters and journalists and Republicans to question Hunter Biden and take a look at that narrative that's been created to the American people?
Of course it's fair game. He is a member of the Biden family. It's fair game if it's done fairly. let me just put that emphasis on it. It is not something that Republicans or opponents have to ignore, but you have to make sure that you're doing it in a fair way. In other words, that it's a fact-based look at Hunter Biden and his entanglements, which have caused some consternation and some problem for Joe Biden. Now, that's absolutely fair. You know, certainly Democrats, as things go on, are going to be looking at members of the Trump family. So
as they have for 4 years, rightfully so.
Exactly. Yeah. So, no, it's fair.
Jeff Holm, our Republican, nice to have you with us. It's been a while since we've all been back in studio. We should mention that for our first hour, we're all in studio looking at each other. We're more than, I guess we're 6 feet apart. But Jeff, what's your answer to that question as to how we deal with this?
My advice would be to focus on the actual, like, corruption part, not the unseemly details of Hunter Biden's life, right? So forget about the whole paternity suit. Forget about, you know, the relationship
child
he had
custody
with Beau's wife, you know, and that kind of stuff. Like, and talk about the real stuff, the real corruption stuff, about how he got a $50,000 a month job at Burisma when he has absolutely no expertise in oil and gas, while his father happened to be the vice president and was overseeing affairs for Ukraine. That's the story, not the other stuff. And if you focus on that instead of his character issues, I think that is the better way to do it.
Does the news media have a responsibility to look into some of these other personal related issues that they would for other candidates? Derek.
I don't think they have a responsibility to look into it if it goes beyond public policy. I don't think there's any great responsibility. And after all, he's not on the ballot. I mean, you're not voting for him. You can say that relates to character in the Biden family. You can make that argument. But I think if you keep it focused on corruption issues that relate to public policy and possibly, undue use of influence, then I think you're on much sounder ground.
Mm-hmm. But the other stuff doesn't even deserve a look-see by the.
Everything is called the news media now, right? So everybody under the sun, from TMZ to the National Enquirer. So I'm not saying it's not.
National Enquirer broke the John Edwards story.
Well, no, I'm not besmirching anyone, but saying the news media is a very broad term.
Right.
So I'm sure that will be a subject of interest for some folks, but I don't think it's really going to move the needle for much of the American electorate.
All right, Jeff, the Washington Post chose today to run clips of secretly recorded conversations between Donald Trump's sister and the niece who's written this recent very scurrilous book about Donald Trump. And it's the front page of the Washington Post today, mm-hmm. and it basically reveals that she doesn't think much of her brother. She questions all the things about his character that have been questioned for the last 4 years. And the story breaks on the eve of the Republican convention and also following the death and the funeral at the White House of his brother, who he described as his better friend.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how do you think people will react to that?
I think the shocking thing for me was the fact that Mary Trump surreptitiously recorded her family members for 15 years. That's insane. That's a character flaw in and of itself, right? I don't think that any of the revelations that that President Trump's sister doesn't like him or doesn't think that he is, you know, a man of high character are going to resonate with anyone persuadable, right? I think that that's, for better or worse, priced in for the past 4 years. And I just don't understand why the Hunter Biden stories, which actually deal with corruption instead of character issues, get set into the back page. When these things break, you know, breathlessly, oh my God, imagine, you know, what his sister had to say about him.
Mm-hmm. When we come back, Derek, it does bring into question the role of the news media in this campaign, what shows they choose to cover and which ones they don't. When we come back, I want to expand our discussion on that matter. 1-800-723-8289. I'm Bruce Dumont. Thanks for joining us.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
A line is a powerful thing. It connects the global economy to your living room, cleaner air to stronger markets, factory floors to less crowded roads. Today's progress to tomorrow's promise. Norfolk Southern. One line, infinite possibilities.
Back on Beyond the Beltway. Thanks very much for joining us. Derek, because you spend so much time in news, explain to the audience, because a lot of people listening to this program think that the national news media especially is very left or very liberal or progressive, whatever, is anti-Republican, certainly anti-Trump. Would you acknowledge that? Now you've been retired. Would you acknowledge that some of that is true vis-a-vis Donald Trump, that maybe the media has gone overboard to make his life miserable?
Well, I think there's an antipathy toward Donald Trump, and I think it goes both ways.
yes.
You remember Donald Trump kind of started this on the day of his inauguration when he started talking about how many people were or weren't on the mall, which, by the way, is completely irrelevant to the event.
Right.
And, I mean, I was on the mall. I can tell you the mall wasn't filled. But who cares? You've just been elected president of the United States,
mm-hmm.
and you're going to make this the highlight issue on what should be the most significant day of your life? Come on. So it kind of started there. And this is a president who's played faster and looser with the facts than anybody I've ever seen. And not just in challenging conventional wisdom, but in challenging well-established things that are known for political gain and to kind of gin up his political base.
Is it the responsibility of the media, however, when he has given a speech and certainly he's provided enough fodder for a lot of negative coverage, but when he gives a speech on a matter, is it the responsibility of the journalist to decide what's right and what's wrong, or is that the role of the loyal opposition? At least that's the way it's been for many, many years.
Well, I think as a reporter, you have a responsibility to report what someone in that kind of position of authority says. But if it is blatantly untrue, I don't mean at the margins, and I don't mean as a matter of opinion. I mean as a matter of fact, then if it's something of importance, I think you have a responsibility within maybe your report or elsewhere in a newscast or a newspaper to point that out. And I think that's responsible context.
Jeff, you have been one observer who's been on this program who is critical of the national news media and the political slant they have from time to time. How do you respond to that same question?
I don't disagree with anything that Derek just said. What I disagree with is the selective application of those principles, right? So when President Trump needs to be fact-checked, they'll cut away from his speech to fact-check him. CNN, who has gone off the deep end here, writes these ridiculous over-the-top chyrons that go underneath like his live speech,
right.
And yet when Joe Biden or when Kamala Harris or when anyone else tells these whoppers, they're just not responded to the same way, and that's what frustrates people. That's what gets people to believe that the media is slanted, is the selective application of those journalistic principles.
Is Fox News part of the media?
Yes.
Yes.
Are they part of the mainstream media?
I mean, I would say so.
I would too.
Right?
So what I'm saying is, the reason I ask the question is, this cuts both ways. Well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, yeah. So,
but when you start with the characterization that the media is anti-Trump or far left, the Fox News is basically an organ of the White House. It was not
the opinion pieces, sure, but the straight news pieces like Chris Wallace, Brett Baer, like they're actually. Like
and
Chris Wallace's interview with
and
Trump.
Shep was as well, exactly. Before he left the network.
But it's not the same on the other networks. There's no straight news on the other networks because like they're all wanting to inject opinion.
But how much of that straight news is the Fox News content? That's maybe what, 2 hours a day?
No. Most during the day.
If you watch them during the day,
I think they are
Fox
a very good.
Well, the president's favorite TV show.
I see that as a programming element. I don't see it as a straight news. But if you watch them from 10 in the morning to 6 at night, you're watching a pretty straight newscast.
I would somewhat disagree. I think it tilts right. But
that's one outlet that tilts right.
It's the biggest one on television.
Would you say the same thing? Would you make the same assessment of MSNBC and CNN?
Oh, absolutely.
And CNN? Okay.
Absolutely. I think MSNBC, and this is, this is where we are in the media, and I think it's problematic because I think well-informed people should really listen with a critical ear, but should really listen to what the opposition says, because I don't think either side is all right or all wrong. And I think by simply, you know, retreating to our amen corners, we continue the vision and not look for places where there can be agreement and places where they could actually be action taken that would benefit the entire country.
I mean, this is actually one of the great things about being a blue state Republican, right? I am surrounded.
I'm trying to figure out what the good things are.
There are very few, but this is one of them. I am surrounded by liberal orthodoxy. My premises are questioned all the time, right? And the people that I know that are on the other side of the spectrum who are also in this blue state have never had their orthodoxies questioned at all. And when they do, they get offended. Like, I lost friends over the 2016 election. And it's like they've never heard an opposing viewpoint. And so that's why all of these leftist talking points get boiled down to the simplest thing. If you don't agree with this, you hate this group.
Well, there is a kind of almost religious orthodoxy that's developed on both sides.
Sure.
And I have heard it among friends that I know. And things are repeated as fact when they are really more of opinions and maybe not even correct as fact.
Yeah.
But in
newsrooms, Derek, where you've spent a lot of time, and I've spent some time in programming departments primarily, but discussing news and talk, the one opinion that everyone seems to nod their head at is one that would be described as a progressive left of center. I don't want to say leftist, but certainly a left of center, a basic fact. They acknowledge it or they can't comprehend or they don't even know. I mean, I know some people, they don't even know conservatives.
I mean, look at what happened with Bret Stephens at the Wall Street Journal when he was hired and the campaign to try and get rid of him. Kevin Williamson and the successful campaign to remove him from the Atlantic. And the most recent conflict with Barry Weiss at the New York Times. Like, these people are not Republican firebrands. This isn't like, I don't know. I mean, you call Kevin Williamson a Republican, he'll fight you. And, you know, these people are cast as these far right, you know, Nazis and all this kind of stuff. And they're just creating the bubbles out of the newsrooms.
I can say that in the newsrooms I worked in, I don't remember political discussions as such.
Sure, but I mean, you'll admit that was obviously a very different time, right? I mean, like, I can't even imagine.
I retired a year ago, so I'm not that old.
Well, no, I'm not trying to say that, right? So, like, I can't imagine going to college today, right? Because, like, I went to college during the first Obama administration, and, you know, you didn't talk about being a Republican at DePaul, right? But, like, people kind of knew, and you wouldn't get ostracized. I actually had some great debates in poli-sci classes, because you'd find like the other two Republicans and then you'd sit with each other and then, you know, you'd kind of be like you versus the class. And that was always fun because it was done in like this spirit of academic debate.
And an exchange of ideas.
Exactly. And nobody was vilified and ad hominems and that kind of stuff. And I can't imagine that happening today.
As it relates to what happened last week and what happened may happen again next week is there was nary a word of the disturbances and unrest in cities at the Democratic convention. Now, I know that a political party wants to accentuate their positive, but does the news media have a responsibility during a four-day extravaganza like the Democrats had to sort of, in their news reporting, bring up the fact that, well, you know, there's other things going on that the Democrats are avoiding, whether it's that or discussions of China? I mean, I was flabbergasted that neither of the things came up.
Well, there wasn't a whole lot of policy discussed, period, but I didn't see that necessarily as a failing simply because you've got at least 2 months more of campaigning, campaign coverage, and also you've got four debates coming up. Mm-hmm. Three one-on-one debates between Biden and President Trump, and of course the vice presidential debate. There's plenty of time to outline policy differences. And as you mentioned, what the Democrats wanted to emphasize is that Joe Biden is not Donald Trump, that he's a nice guy. I mean, Trump said himself, when integrity's on the ballot, character's on the ballot, that's what he is running on. And to the extent that policy was not discussed, every election where there's an incumbent, Bruce, you know, is a referendum on the on the incumbent.
Right.
And especially when you have such an unorthodox and incendiary incumbent as President Trump, that is the case as well. I know people would like to have a more, especially people who are really into politics would like to have a more informed and in-depth policy debate. But I think you're going to see much more of that actually in the debates. And that's why they're going to be so key, especially when candidates largely are prevented from doing much campaigning in person.
At this point, Jeff, what would you say is the key issue? Having watched the Democratic convention, and I think the Democrats made a good case that Joe Biden is a decent, honest guy. And I know there's probably people listening that just almost drove off the road. But again, I've been watching Joe Biden from really the beginning. I mean, the story of what happened on his election night when he lost his wife and daughter, it made him a front page story on his first day as a politician. And so I have followed his career. And he does come across like a neat and a good, decent man. And the only besmirchment of the family has been, his son.
I mean,
he shouldn't be blamed for that. When we come back, I want to talk more about the other issues that Republicans are concerned about.
Here's how you can make your own face covering in a few easy steps with items you can find around the house, like an old scarf, a bandana or a hand towel, or you can make a face covering out of an old t-shirt. Fold it to the middle from the bottom. Fold it to the middle from the top. Fold it again to the middle from the bottom, and again from the top. And then two rubber bands, one on one side and one on the other side. Then you fold either side to the middle, and you have yourself cloth face covering. It's that easy.
With instant acceleration, electric cars are more fun to drive and more affordable than ever. Electric cars are here. Plug in to the present.
Bruce DuMont back on Beyond the Beltway. Thanks very much for joining us. We're going to take a moment now and let each of our guests tell you a little bit more about themselves. And we'll start with you, Jeff Holm.
Hi, my name is Jeff Holm. I'm the political director for the Young Republican National Federation, which is a nationwide organization of young Republican chapters that helps bring young people into the party, adjust messaging of the party towards young people, and most importantly, to actually do get out the votes, get out the vote efforts every election cycle.
Derek Blakely.
I am a born and bred Chicagoan from the great south side of Chicago. That's what Richard J. Daley used to call it. And I spent 40 years in television news as a CBS news correspondent based in Chicago, London, and Germany, and followed by more than 30 years at two network-owned stations in Chicago, the NBC and CBS-owned stations. And I retired last year, and since then I've been doing some teaching and some writing, primarily for the Center for Illinois Politics, a data-driven policy website.
Okay, thanks very much. Jeff, I asked before the break, what is the issue when you go out on your work for your organization? What is the issue that you hear most from Republicans? What do they want to know?
I think a lot of people are sometimes frustrated with the Twitter account. I think that's the number one gripe. I think that a lot of...
Explain that.
I think that sometimes President Trump can undo... He kind of always needs to be the center of attention, right? And so there have been times where the Democrats are destroying themselves, right? Like the Democrat primaries were a great example. And he would tweet about something unrelated and ignite some controversy, and the media was happy to obviously go after whatever controversy because it gets them away from, you know, talking about how the Democrats are destroying each other. So things like that. I think that a lot of that is priced in, though, right? It's one of those things where I wish he could do it better, but I'm still going to support him. The idea, especially when you hear President Obama's most recent interview saying that Bernie Sanders' positions and Joe Biden's positions are essentially the same, right? It's that kind of stuff that makes people go, well, okay, I mean, I don't like this, but it's better than the alternative. And if you look at the actual accomplishments, right, whether you look at the economic recovery, obviously before the blue states decided they all needed to lock everything down in an attempt to blow up the economy, if you look at the recovery since, if you look at, you know, the fact that we have a space program again, like there's all these things you can point to that, he's mean, just doesn't seem to resonate with people.
Well, it seems to me it resonates with a lot of people who already dislike him. So
right.
I guess your reaction, Derek, you had a follow up.
Well, I think that if what you're saying is that President Trump is his own worst enemy in a lot of instances, I think that's true. And I think his tweeting does undermine people looking at him differently and maybe focusing on the accomplishments. But, you know, when you're the ringmaster of the circus, it's hard not to ignore the circus. He's the president of the United States.
I mean, if he's the ringmaster of the circus, then that kind of makes the national media like the clapping seals, right? Because there's nothing that he can say that they won't be like, oh my God, we've got to follow this topic.
Well, he is the president of the United States.
Sure.
I mean, that's like, you know, do you ignore what the Pope says? That comes with the position. I mean, can't say we're going to ignore what the president says today and we're going to focus on this.
Derek, one of his concerns, and I think he takes a lot of things way too personal. He doesn't seem he's not a thick-skinned politician. Is that he doesn't believe he gets any credit for anything, the positive things. I mean, if you look at the network newscast, I mean, it is nonstop bombardment of some negative thing, accentuating the negative that's happened. So he won't get a credit for doing anything, when he does something good.
Well, you know, I think he got credit for the economic recovery when the stock market was doing well and the economy was flourishing. He took credit for it, and I think he got credit for it. It has been something of a bifurcated recovery. And even now, I mean, the stock market is soaring, but a lot of people are in pain as a result of COVID, the unemployment and the distress that's caused. That's been his major accomplishment, and since.
I mean, what about peace in the Middle East, right? The UAE and the Israelis just normalized relations. Like, if that happened and there's five more Arab states that are supposed to be coming. Well, Morocco's not an Arab state.
That is a major, major deal.
If that happened under the Obama administration, we would never hear the end of it. It would be nonstop, and rightfully so, because it is an incredible accomplishment. The United Arab Emirates supported the Palestinians in the Second Intifada.
Does that move votes? Who is moved by? I agree with you, but who is moved by that? With all the issues that affect people on a daily basis, where does that issue fit? Does it make the top 20?
Does anybody know about it? Right? I mean, that's the challenge, right?
Even if they knew about it, does it move the needle for the average guy who's making or woman who's trying to make a living?
No, because typically when this is polled, you know, the top three are usually the economy, personal financial security, you know, well-being and all that kind of stuff. It's kind of like Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Like once my family is good and I'm you know, okay, not worried about, you know, whether my state is going to decide that my business is unessential and I might go bankrupt. Once they don't have to worry about those things, then they worry about the things higher order. Mm-hmm. So, yes, I mean, that's why the economy is super important. And you can tell that the economy is recovering because there are outlets like The Atlantic trying to claim that the reason for the economic recovery is because Trump inherited it from President Obama.
One of the other big issues that has not received a lot of coverage, and that is there was a report recently that, according to our intelligence sources, they have said that the Russians are trying, or Vladimir Putin is trying to help Donald Trump. And that same report said that the Chinese are trying to help Joe Biden. When you watch the story unfold on television, it's all about Trump and the Russians. Nobody spends any time talking about the Chinese, alleged preference for Joe Biden. So my question to you, again, as a reporter, knowing that you have these great countries out there trying to disrupt our election process, how do you, as a reporter, and how does someone listening or watching one of your broadcasts know if a story that you're about to break is maybe coming out of Moscow or Beijing?
Well, I haven't heard that the Russians have infiltrated America's newsrooms, but
with stories they could. I mean, how, if they're doing it with bots and they're doing it on the internet, I mean, isn't part of what they would attempt to do is to try to plant a story in a major news operation?
I don't know what they would try to do. I would not put it behind them. And certainly they have used disinformation to try to affect the electorate and public opinion. That would not be a major concern for me if I were a voter. But to go back to what you said before, I think, frankly, I had not heard the report that the Chinese were working on behalf of Joe Biden. That could be, I mean, you can't read everything and see everything.
I just want to make my point. You have just made my point, because the story that came out, the original story, the Senate Intelligence Report, said both things. But the only thing that people are following up on, the news media, including Chuck Todd, who's obsessed with the Russians, the only story he brings up is their alleged involvement with the Trump campaign. They mention nothing about the you don't even know about it. And I would say that most people don't even know about it.
I would agree it should be reported. I don't know that it hasn't been reported. I just said I haven't seen it. But certainly the Trump Russia story has a longer tail that goes all the way back to 2016. I mean,
a fabricated story.
Yeah.
Too.
So this is the thing, right? So we heard for 3 years, you know, the Mueller investigation.
No, I don't mean, when I say Trump Russia, I don't mean that Trump was cooperating with Russia, but Russia was trying to influence the election in favor of Trump, which is what the Senate Republicans said.
Okay. So this is the problem, right? Is that there's a difference between a nation trying to influence our elections, right? Because we're, you know, one of the most important economies in the world. It makes sense, right? I mean, hell, the Obama administration tried to work against Netanyahu in Israel, right? So the idea that they tried to influence the election by, you know, whatever, and then that they did, that's the logical leap that many on the left want to make. That, I mean, people believe on the left believe that Russia changed votes.
I don't know what people on the left believe. That's never been reported.
I can pull up the poll for you right now.
No, I'm not disputing what a poll says. I'm just saying that, to my knowledge, I have never seen the information reported in that way. The information I've always seen reported was that Russia was meddling in the election to try to help Trump, which does not mean and does not say that Trump was cooperating in that.
Is a $20,000 Facebook ad buy of bad memes with Jesus arm wrestling Satan, like, is that actually, because that's what came out of these bot farms, right? Stupid political, like, bad memes like that. Is that considered meddling, or is that, like, inconsequential because nobody who's persuadable would care about that kind of thing?
I don't quite understand the question.
What I'm saying is, okay, so let's say they made a $20,000 Facebook ad buy, which they did, right? These, like, Russian bot farms. And they put out these bad political memes that were just, like, I don't even know. But one of them was Jesus arm wrestling Satan, and Satan saying, if Hillary wins, I win, or something like that. That's the quality of interference that the Russian bot farms did in our election.
Well, I'm just telling you what the Senate Republicans reported. And that was their conclusion. I don't know if they rated the quality of the interference, but they did say there
definitely
there was to influence the election.
There was influence, and there continues to be influence. We'll talk about it more when we come back.
Dallas, St. Louis, Nashville, Tuscaloosa. All major cities to feel the destruction caused by a direct hit from a tornado. Is Chicago next? It's not a question of if, but when, and the clock is ticking. Learn what to do now at ready.illinois.gov to become tornado ready.
Bruce DuMont back. Thanks very much for joining us. We will go to calls. Let's go to Joy listening to us in Spokane, Washington. Joy, are you there? Go ahead. Hello, Joy. Are you there? Joy on line one on our great new phone system. Is she there or not? Well, Joy is not there. Derek, let's come back to you. And another big issue that has not received a lot of coverage is the impact, if any, does the inroads attempted by the Republicans into the African-American community. Is it likely that any of those are going to be successful?
Not in a way I think that's going to come close to influencing the result of the election. From what I've been reading, Donald Trump may run slightly better in African-American communities than he did 4 years ago. Mm-hmm. But I have not seen anything to indicate that it's significant enough that it is going to be impactful.
What do you think about that, Jeff? There has been, at least to a lot of Republicans, there's been a lot of time spent in trying to reach out to the black community. Mm-hmm. Is this going to be a year where it might pay off?
I would certainly hope so. And I think that some of the places where there's a lot of civil unrest, like our own fair city, are actually helping President Trump's case, because you see the mayors like Mayor Lightfoot, who decides, you know, these protesters are peaceful, but she doesn't want them on her block. And they see that kind of hypocrisy, because a lot of these people who are Antifa and that kind of stuff are overwhelmingly white. They are overwhelmingly from privilege, and they go into these poorer neighborhoods to play act at revolution. There was a great video.
Yeah, but the protests in Chicago, mm-hmm, are Black Lives Matter. They've been projected to be every single night. They're, mm-hmm, the ones that wanted to get into the mayor's block to protest, and they're talking about reparations. They're talking about demanding all kinds of things, defunding the Chicago Police Department.
Yeah, I mean,
they're not stopping on that issue.
There's a billboard.
We had that scene just last week where there was a group that wanted to march in Inglewood, and they were stopped.
Yes, that's exactly what I was about to talk about.
By the Inglewood residents themselves,
exactly.
Who said, "No, take that nonsense out of here." And by the way, there was also a poll done by the Gallup Center on Black Voices, which raised a question about abolishing police. The poll showed that 22% of blacks, 22% supported that,
right.
20% of Latinos, 12% of whites. So in terms of, defunding police, whatever that means, there may be more support depending on how you characterize that. But in terms of abolishing police, people in crime-ridden neighborhoods know that they need police protection. It's the kind of police protection, mm-hmm, that they want. They don't want police protection that abuses the rights, or where police use undue force and are not punished for it.
There's another thing that's easy to understand, and that is, again, the news media has not covered it at all. I'm sure Donald Trump will mention it once or twice, and that is Kamala Harris. She is the one that came up in the primaries when she said she wanted to abolish ICE, mm-hmm, abolish ICE, and she also said that she wanted to end, she did not want it to be illegal again to sneak into the country. She wanted
open borders, legitimize
that.
Right.
Yeah.
So
my question is, those are issues, it seems to me, those are issues that a lot of Republicans would be concerned about, and frankly, a lot of Democrats.
And that's why
and they haven't even asked her about that.
Yes, and that's why. And you know, after the convention the other night, there was a video where reporters were told, you know, to go outside or they're going to miss the fireworks. And instead of staying around to ask questions of, you know, the people that were just nominated to one of the two major parties in the country, they all ran outside to watch fireworks, right? So it shows you kind of where the priorities are. But it also shows you why the media is in such a hurry to paint Kamala Harris as a moderate when she is not a moderate at all. She is this is a woman who publicly accused her debate opponent of sexual assault, of racism, and now she's running on his ticket? Like, that seems to me like this woman
just
after power.
And she left. It's just the debate.
Right. But like, these are issues that do not have wide stream support. Like, if you go back to the Black Lives Matter, I think that there was a moment after George Floyd was murdered that there was going to be broad-based support for reforming qualified immunity, for reforming mm-hmm. police unions, to talk about excessive use of force, what's appropriate, and all that kind of stuff. And then these organizations under the flag of Black Lives Matter come out and start talking about reparations and endorsing looting, and it just, there goes the broad base of support.
Derek, your response to that?
Well, I certainly thought that the comments made by the Black Lives Matter spokesman in Chicago, where she basically said looting equaled reparations, was ridiculous. It harmed the argument. I think there is a legitimate argument for reparations, but it harmed that argument, certainly. However, I think those are still the kind of reform measures that you were mentioning are still legitimate, still have to be considered, and still should be for the well-being of everyone in the country. Although, you know, the argument, and I think there was an argument originally that the protests were not the same as the looting. But when you have statements like that, it blurs that line, which is highly problematic. Back to Kamala Harris. Let me just say this about her. I think painting her as a wild-eyed radical is quite extreme. I mean, she was a state attorney general. She was a prosecuting attorney, and she also has been endorsed basically by a lot of leaders on Wall Street.
I didn't say she was a radical.
Well,
I said she was an authoritarian.
A lot of leaders on Wall Street because
we got to pause
because she's not Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders.
We got to pause. I'm Bruce Dumont. Back for another 4 hour. Don't go away.
Not wearing a mask in public is like not wearing a seatbelt because no one else is.
Or not wearing a life jacket because it's uncomfortable.
Or not wearing a helmet because it's just one play.
Or not putting me in a car seat because we're only going down the block.
A mask is like anything that keeps us safe. It only works if you wear it.
So wear a mask when you're out in public because we're all safer and stronger when we go all in, Illinois.
Today, fresh fruits and vegetables will go from a field in California to a grocer in Miami. A bottle of beer from Eagle Pass will journey to a restaurant in Manhattan. A 2x4 in Oregon will find its way to a townhome in Denver. A hybrid will say goodbye to Detroit and hello to a showroom in Austin. While a steel beam will leave a mill in Illinois for a high-rise in Phoenix. And a flat screen in China will head to an electronics store in Memphis. Because today, as every day, wherever you find business, you'll find us.